All right, it's good to be here this morning. When you get my age, it's good to be anywhere. I wrestled with that clock last night. I'm sure that y'all did too. And even in the hotel where I was staying, the fellow couldn't get the time right. And I've asked him several questions, and they said, well, we'll find out for you. But I appreciate the motel room. Been very nice again. I miss my wife being with me. She was with me last year. It was in the summertime. She's teaching school for us. And I appreciate the invitation to come back and be with you. I certainly appreciate the very wonderful meals that we've had with the pastor and his wife and family. And then yesterday, those breaded pork chops and ham and chicken again and all that. I took some home with me. Brother Raymond fixed me up a plate, and I was so full when I got home I couldn't eat it. So I'm thinking about having a snack later today in that. And let me say this at the outset. I appreciate all the kind remarks that your pastor has made concerning me and these other fellows and preachers and so forth. I know they appreciate it too. And that's an encouragement to me and a blessing. And I've learned something from him and what he has said this week to you. It's very apparent that that the pastor and his family love you folks. I mean, that's very apparent. Amen. And it's also very apparent that you love them, and that's good. And I've been told that if you love him, them, and they love you, that makes a good marriage. That's really a wonderful thing, and it's a blessing. Listen, God's people ought to be able to get along, and they ought to be able to love each other and care about one another and care about their heartaches. I don't know Brother Jeff that well, but evidently you were in an accident and you're healing and so forth. Just had a birthday. How old were you? 34. That is nothing, is it? Nothing. We have teachers in our school that teach for, I'm the principal too, and they teach for us, and they'll come in the office and they'll say, oh, I'm turning 30, the ladies especially. I'm turning 30, I'm turning 31. And I just look at them and grin. I said, I've done that twice. That's not a big deal. And so I try to make them feel better. You may have heard this, but an elderly lady, it says, had just returned to her home from an evening of church services when she was startled by an intruder in her house. She caught the man in the act of robbing her home of its valuables, and she yelled, stop, Acts 2:38. And the guy kept on, and she said, stop, Acts 2:38. Well, by that time, the burglar had stopped in his tracks, and the woman called the police. The police came, they arrested him. And the police officer said, well, what upset you about this lady that you just stopped in your tracks and you didn't continue the robbery and you just waited for us to arrest you? He said, the lady was yelling scripture at you, Acts 2:38. He said, oh, my goodness. He said, I thought she said she had an axe and 2:38 that you get me. So if all else fails, just holler scripture at them and see if that doesn't help. I invite your attention this morning to Luke chapter 19. Luke chapter 19. We're going to read verses 41 through 44. Luke chapter 19, verses 41 through 44. If you're able to stand in honor of the reading of the Word of God, I would ask you to do that this morning, and then we'll get right into the message today. Now, we're going to go past 12 o'clock, it looks like, doesn't it? But you'll still get to eat, and I'll get hungry too, and so forth. And we'll pray the Lord bless in this service today. Luke chapter 19, verse number 41. The Bible says, and when he was come, it's talking about Jesus, when he was come near, he beheld the city and he wept over it. Now this city is Jerusalem, saying, excuse me, if thou hast known, even thou at least in this thy day, the things which belong unto thy peace, but now they are hid from thine eyes. For the day shall come upon thee that thine enemies shall cast a trench about thee, and compass thee round, and keep thee in on every side, and shall lay thee even with the ground, and thy children within thee, and they shall not leave in thee one stone upon another, because thou knewest not the time of thy visitation. But I want you to notice our text verse today, where we'll start from, talking about Jesus when he was come to Jerusalem. It says, when he was come near, he beheld the city, and he wept over it. The message today is things to weep over. Things to weep over. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the day that you've given us, the blessings that you have bestowed upon us, even this week and even today. We thank you for the music. We thank you for the young people, the pastor, the musicians, Lord, and we thank you for the special songs. Thank you for the Sunday school lesson. We pray now that you speak to all of our hearts. We pray that our minds will be clear of those things that would distract us, that we'll not think about anything but your word and what we need from your word in this day in which we live. We're thankful for the visitors that are here today. I thank you for the opportunity that I could come back and be with these people again. Forgive me of my sins, I pray, and fill me with your spirit. And I pray that you'd give me liberty to say the things you'd have to be said to this eternity-bound congregation on this day. And I pray if there's someone unsaved, that today would be the day of salvation for them. For it's in Jesus' precious and holy name we pray and ask it all. And amen. Thank you. You may be seated. When you think about the word weep, you think about somebody not just shedding a tear, but you think about them maybe sobbing. You think about them crying uncontrollably sometimes. And I think about Jesus Christ as we read the Bible, as we study the Bible. The New Testament, we see the life of Christ, and we use Christ, and we should as Christians. He should be our pattern. A Christian is to be Christ-like. He's our pattern. He's our blueprint. He's our example. And he paid the ultimate sacrifice for our sins at Calvary. And so when we think about that in Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse number 4, and I won't have you turn there for sake of time, but it states that there's a time to weep. There is a time to weep, and it also states there's a time to laugh. Now, most of the people that know me real well know that I kid and laugh a lot. And I'll tell you why I do that, because when I'm serious, I'm usually crying. And things of God are serious. I like to have a good time. I like to laugh and all. But the things of God are serious. In John chapter 11, verse 35, we know the shortest verse in the Bible. Every child, every probably adult will know this verse. It's just a simple verse in two words, and it says, Jesus wept. But the reason he was weeping was he saw the concern and the care and the mourning of Mary and Martha, the sisters of Lazarus. And Lazarus was a friend of Jesus Christ. You know, we go to our friend's funeral, and we weep, we cry, we shed tears. We go to a loved one's funeral, and we cry not only at the funeral and maybe at home, but days after and times that we think about them, and we cry. I mentioned several times that my dad passed away just about a year ago. And I was at a funeral of a preacher, Howard Sears, there in Middletown on Tuesday, I believe it was. And I sat there in that service, and as they talked about him, it made me think of my dad. And some of the things they said about him, many of the things they said about him, could apply to my dad. And I miss him every day. I think about him every day. My mother will come to my office and she'll sit down and we'll be talking and it comes up about my dad and we begin to cry. And then when I'm preaching, many times I'll say, my dad in our church, my dad pastored there for 20 years and I've pastored for 25, and I'll say, you remember what my dad used to say? And so people ask if you miss them, you miss them every day. They're things that we weep over. Sometimes God's people get dried up, I guess you could say, and we don't weep. I remember many, many years ago in a church in Detroit, Michigan, when my dad was working there. He was not the pastor. And, you know, we talk about weeping and crying and so forth. And people didn't cry much. They didn't weep much. They'd make a lot of money. And really, they were getting self-sufficient, they thought, and all those kind of things. I'll never forget, my dad told me this story, and I remembered it, about this man that walked in off the street. He evidently was a homeless man, and he didn't have much, and he wanted to say something to the church, and the pastor allowed him to speak. He began to get up, and he began to tell about his life, and then he told a story about his dog, that his dog had just got run over. And he was telling that, and I mean everybody in the places, by that time got tears in their eyes and everything, and they gave him a big offer. I don't know if the story was true or not, but it shows us something, that sometimes we weep over things that are more insignificant than we do the things that we should really weep over. And this morning I want to talk to you about three things that we're to weep over. And when Jesus wept, I believe he was showing his concern. I believe he was showing his compassion. I believe he was showing his care. And sometimes when we're talking to people and we're emotional and we begin to cry, they realize that we really do care. And we have compassion, and we have concern. And so that's what we're talking about this morning. First of all, number one, Jesus was weeping over the city of Jerusalem. Jerusalem was his city. The Jews are his people, his chosen people. And I've heard the prayers about Israel, and I pray that the United States will always stay on the side of Israel. That's God's people, and God is going to take care of his people, and he's going to bless his people. And as long as we're on their side, we're in good shape. But once we turn away from them, then we're in bad shape. But Jesus was concerned about his city because he knew what was going to happen. He knew the judgment that was coming. He knew the future for the Israelites. And yet, he stood there knowing that. And you think about this. God knows everything. He knows the beginning. He knows the end. He knows the end from the beginning. He set all this in motion before the worlds were even formed and so forth. And God knows all about it. And still here he is weeping over his people. It showed compassion. It showed concern. It showed care. When he wept over Lazarus dying, Jesus knew that he could raise Lazarus up. He knew that he was going to come forth out of that grave. He knew that he was going to say the words, loose him and let him go. And yet he still cared, and he had compassion, and he was concerned for him. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we need to weep over our city. Most people have never heard of Girdler, Kentucky. Most people never have. But God knows about Girdler, Kentucky, doesn't he? God knows about your church. God knows about your people. God knows about your families. Sometimes we think because we live in a bigger city and maybe have a larger congregation and things like that, that God cares about us. But God cares about this place right here. I think about the gospel going on here, the truth being taught here. I think about the songs you're singing and the influence that you have on these young people and the importance that they are to this church. God knows all about that. God cares about you. No matter how small, no matter where it is, if people never heard of it, doesn't matter. God's heard of it. And we need to weep over our city, and I'm sure that you folks do. The Jerusalem was where the temple was, but the city had rejected Jesus Christ as Messiah. But these were his people. I've told people that I've gone up on our hill there on Eaton Road Hill near our church in Hamilton, Ohio. And I've gone up there, and you can overlook the whole city from there. The city has grown in the last 40 years. It has really grown. And in the neighborhood where we live, right there off Melville Avenue, they put some 200 homes just behind us in the last few years. And I can go up there on that hill. I heard my dad talk about this. And that's where I got the idea. And I go up there on that hill and I look over that city. And I'm telling you, I weep over our city. Our city's got a mess just like the United States got a mess. Our city's got a mess just like the world's got a mess. But I care about our city. That's where I live. That's where my family is. That's where our church is. That's where churches that we fellowship with, many of them are there. That's where my grandchildren are. That's where my children are. I weep over our city. I think it's time God's people got serious and we really cared and we really had compassion and it drove us emotionally to think about what's happening in our lives, what's happening in our city. You know, many times they think, well, a little city doesn't have drug problems, alcohol problems, and all those kind of things, doesn't have meth labs and all, but that's not true, is it? It's everywhere. It's all over the world. And let me tell you, it is destroying people. And God knows whether we really care or not. Do we just get self-satisfied and I pray for my four and no more? Or do we really care about everybody in this community? One of the things I notice about this church is those guys over there, every time you have a meal, you take a meal over to them. They know you care about them, don't they? They know you care about them. These young people know you care about them. You take time with them. That's not wasted time. That's wonderful time. Thank God for it. And not just young people, but people that are in accidents and things like that. And that prayer list you got, I've never seen a prayer list that long before. You think about that. Usually we'll just kind of put several names there and all the other things that we put. But that, what a prayer list that is. That shows that you care. Now let me ask you a question. And I'm not going to indict anybody, but how many times do you go over that and you think about each individual? And you weep over them, whatever their condition is, if they're lost, if they're not well, if they've got family problems or marital problems or whatever the case may be. You know what? God knows all about that. And I'm telling you, when we care about people and we pray about them, they may not even hear our prayers, but God ministers to their hearts and to their lives. So we need to weep over our city. Secondly, not only do we need to weep over our cities, but I think we need to weep over broken homes. I told you last night about my son and his wife leaving him for another man and divorcing him and how that broke our hearts and it broke up his home and his family and two little daughters and things like that. And you think about that, it's high time that we wept over broken homes. Jesus wept. Jesus was concerned. Turn to Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 through 16. We're talking about our example, our pattern to go by. And we see how he cares for us and how he cares for the things of our lives. In Hebrews chapter 4 and verse number 14, here's what the Bible says. I like that. Thus saith the Lord. Hebrews chapter 4 and verse number 14. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that has passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. I don't know if you've experienced it. Maybe some of you have. Maybe you come from a broken home. We used to have a daycare center, and about half the daycare center, those children were from broken homes. We have a Christian school now, and several of the children that are in our school are from broken homes. And I can tell you this from experience, from my son going through that. When that happens, when that home is busted up, when those lives are pulled apart, nobody wins and everybody loses. I'm telling you, you talk about weeping and crying. My wife and I, we walked the floor at night over our son. He was a preacher. He was my associate pastor. His wife walked off and left him for another man. It broke our hearts. You talk about weeping. But you know what I learned? I learned to be more understanding, be more sympathetic, be more caring when other people go through that. I learned a hard lesson during that time. And we wept and we wept and we wept. And we asked God why. And we couldn't understand why all this happened. And we still don't have all the answers. But we know that God is still a sovereign God. And God still cares. And God loves us. And God weeps over us. I believe that with all of my heart. Amen. Love has died, sometimes they'll say. You know, I've had people come to my office, and by the time they come to the pastor's office, they've usually made up their mind. And one or the other of the couple will say, well, I don't love him, or I don't love her, and I don't know if I ever loved him. And all that stuff goes on. It's the same old thing all the time that I hear about. But nobody wins and everybody loses. And let me tell you who loses more than anybody. It is the children. You know why? Because they think it's their fault for some reason. When my son and his wife went through the divorce, the kids were just real small at that time. And I'm telling you, they cried and cried and cried and cried. And it broke our hearts. You know what? We ought to weep over the broken homes and people that we come in contact with. And our world's in a mess. And people just say, well, we just can't get along. And we're gonna just split up. And nobody will get hurt. It hurts everybody and affects everybody. And it affects the church of the living God every time that happens. It happens in preachers' homes. It happens in deacons' homes. It happens in Sunday school teachers' homes. It happens in all people's homes. We think it can't happen to us. Don't say that. Because when you get to thinking it won't happen to you, it will come to your house. I've learned not to be as judgmental about some things as I used to be. Should we weep over these conditions? Yes, we should weep over our families. We should weep over our church family. We should weep over our town. We should not be immune to the things that are going wrong in our world and in our own little world and the families that we have and where we live and so forth. Thirdly, not only that, should we weep over our cities and over broken homes, but I believe we ought to weep over backslidden children of God. Churches ought to be packed. Churches ought to be filled. We're living in the last days. Preacher talked about this more. We're living in the last days. You know, sometimes when we're in war and war first starts and breaks out, and then people all of a sudden they get religious, they come to church, and then you just see it falling away and falling away and falling away. But these church pews ought to be packed this morning. In our church, they're not packed, but they ought to be packed. People of God ought to be in those pews. You say they're saved. They say they're church member. They say they love God. Well, it's time for us to get concerned about those folk and pray over them. Have you ever been backslidden? Huh? I have. They say the best place to be backslidden is in Bible college. Young preacher, get backslidden in Bible college. You know, you can get backslidden in the pew. You can be backslidden in the pulpit. We can all be backslidden. We ought to be concerned about that. That ought to break our heart when we're in a backslidden condition. I've asked people. I know people sometimes in the church, and you can see them getting crossways and upset and whatever. And I go up to them, and I used to do this. I'm not as brave anymore because I don't know what they're going to do. But I used to say, are you backslidden? You know, are you kind of nervous? No, I'm not backslidden. Why would you think? That's a pretty good sign right there, isn't it? If somebody asked me, are you backslidden, preacher? I said, I may be. Would you pray for me? Do you care enough to pray for me that I won't be backslidden? We have a lot of backslidden church members that are not in church, that are not serving God, that used to teach Sunday school, that used to come to church all the time, that used to do this, used to do that, used to visit, and all those kind of things, used to do all those things. You know what? If we're not closer to God today than when we were saved, then we've gone backwards, haven't we? You know, backsliding is just to go back. And we all are prone to do that. I'm reminded of a song that there was a man, Robert Robinson was his name. And he wrote a song, and I don't know if it's in these books or not. I think it is. Let's see if it is. Come Thy Fount. Come Thy Fount. Is that in here? Yes, 190. But this man had gotten, he'd written this song before, many years before, and he'd gotten out in the world, and he'd gotten backslidden. And he was somewhere at a meeting of some kind, and this woman got up, and she began to read this poem. And the poem was the words to this song that he had written. And listen to the words. It says, Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount, I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Then verse 3 says, Oh, to grace, how great a debtor. Daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. And the story goes that he was in that meeting and that lady read that poem. And that was a song that he had written. And it gripped his heart. And he asked God to forgive him. And he wanted to be back where he was in tune with his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Aren't you glad today that we can ask God to forgive us? He does forgive us. If we're backslidden, whatever's going on in our life, if he's not first in our life, if he's not the most important person in our life, we can ask God to forgive us and restore us to fellowship and all of those kind of things, and it changes us. I know people that used to attend our church, and they used to be faithful to our church, and they used to be involved in our church, and they're no longer doing that. And that breaks my heart. And so we weep over them, we cry over them, we think about them all the time. And we should weep over those people, and we should care, and we should let them know that we care. I told you at the beginning of the message, when I get serious about things, I usually cry. And there are people in my family that have been backslidden, away from God, away from church. There are people that I know got out in the world and not living for God, with family members that are lost. And I'll talk about them in a minute. But been backslidden. I talked about my brother some this week. And when it's your brother or your sister or your friend, and they're backslidden, they're away from God, and you see that God's not as important in their lives anymore as it used to be, that gets a hold of you. And you weep about that. And you cry about that. Many people don't even know that. They don't know that we care. They don't know. Many people probably don't even know they're on the prayer list. Many people don't know that you've prayed for them, cried for them, and so forth. And maybe God will give you the opportunity when you see them, just in a nice way, to say, listen, we miss you. I've had people that left our church and they were upset, and as far as I knew, they hadn't caused any problem. And I said, look, if you ever want to come back, you're welcome to come back. People don't know what to do with that. They don't know what to say. I've had people that left and they're not mad at anybody, and they love me and they love the church, but they're going somewhere else. And I see them out somewhere and they come over to me and they hug me and they tell me how much they love me. And I say, we sure do miss your church. We sure would love to have you back. And they said, don't give up on us. We may do it. I've witnessed, and I was youth director for many years, and a lot of the children have grown up, and some of them are in our church and some of them are not in our church. And I'll see them out working somewhere, and they'll see me, and some of them have grown up to the fact place I don't even know who they are, really. And they'll say, Brother Riddick, you remember me, my name's so-and-so. And I try to remember them while they're talking. And some of them will say, I'm in church and I'm serving God, I'm living for God. That blesses my heart. But some of them, they won't talk about it. And I talk to them, and they know what they need. They know they need the Lord. They know they need to be back in church. They know they're backslidden. They know that. But they also, I want them also to know that I care about them, that I haven't given up and God hasn't given up. Listen, my son that was here the other night, and I told you about the problem he's going through, one of the things that I told our church time and time again about their family and their members of their church, not to ever give up on them. That was my son. I wasn't going to give up on him. I didn't condone what was going on in his life when he was away from the Lord. But I still loved him. I still prayed for him. And he had a place to come back to. You know why? When you're doing what God would have you do, and these people get right with God, they want to come right back here. When your family gets right, and with you and with God, they'll have a home to come back to. You know what? The things of God are not grievous. They're for our benefit. They're for our blessing as we read the Word of God. Then we need to, last of all, weep over the lost multitude. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I don't have to spend a lot of time here. Let's turn to Psalm 126, verse 5 and 6. Psalm 126, verse 5 and 6. You have lost family members. I have lost family members. We have people that we care about, that we have witnessed to, that we have prayed for, that come to the services and have not been saved. But the Bible says this in Psalm 126, 5 and 6. They that sow in tears shall reap in joy. He that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. Now, I believe that's true. That's the Word of God. I believe that if we go, as the Bible says, they that sow in tears shall reap in joy. I have lost family members. But I talk to them many times. I just cry. I'm so concerned about them. I'm not only concerned about my own family, but I'm concerned about other people's families. Listen, who in their right mind would want anybody to die and burn in hell forever and ever and ever? When my dad was in hospice the last week of his life, there was a Christian nurse. She's a judge's wife. Her children had attended our school, graduated from our school. And she was a Christian, and she'd come into the room, and she said, "In this room where your dad is," she said, "you can feel the peace, and you can feel the love, and you can feel the joy that's here." And she said, "But I go in some other rooms, and you can feel the uneasiness. And you can feel them trying just to hold on to the loved one. And you can feel the no hope, the helplessness of the people." And she said she'd been in rooms when people were dying, and they were crying out and screaming that the fire was getting them and they were burning as they died. We have a lady in our church. I have several ladies that are nurses, and one this week stopped at my principal's office door, and she was talking to me, and she was telling me about people that she'd been in the room with that died, and how they were screaming and crying because they were feeling the fires of hell already. Now, I don't know about all that. I've never heard anybody do that, but they tell me that's true. I don't want anybody to go to hell, do you? I will tell you, I would do anything humanly possible to keep people from going to hell. That's why we preach the gospel. That's why we travel miles and miles to preach to people, to warn them of the end time of eternity without Christ, that you must have two birthdays. Right. Not only coming into this world, but your salvation birthday when you were saved, when the Lord saved you. And I care about other people. We knock on doors. We visit people. As Brother Ollie said last night, even him going to Spanish-speaking people, sometimes they slam the door in the face. I've had the door slammed in my face. But I've got the good news. I've got what they need. I don't try to be offensive with it. I just try to tell them that I care about them, and I want them to be saved. Sometimes we have people that claim to be saved, but they never come to church. They never bring their children. And I don't understand how a person could profess Christ and stay out of church and not tell their children about Jesus Christ and his power. Say, I don't understand that. If there's anybody in the world, when my wife and I, when we brought those boys in the world, if there's anybody in the world we want to be saved, it was those boys. Amen. I had the privilege of baptizing my sons. I thank God for that. They were saved and baptized. When my grandchildren came into the world, I prayed that God would save them. And God has saved them. I have two step-grandchildren and two by my son. And all four of them profess Christ, and I had the opportunity to baptize all four of my grandchildren. Now listen, I want that. I wanted that. I desired that. I prayed about that. I wept over that, that God would save them. But I don't. It's not just about my four. It's about your children. It's about your family. And listen, folks, if we really care, if we're really concerned, if we're really compassionate, we're going to pray for the lost, we're going to witness to the lost, and we're going to be an example to the lost and tell them about Jesus Christ and his power to save. How much do we really care? If we care, we'll tell them. If we care, we'll go. If we care, we'll live the Christ life before them so that they might see Christ in our lives. There's a song that says, weeping only lasts for the night, but joy comes in the morning. I have a friend of mine that is legally blind, and he has MS. And I talk to him a lot, and he's a Christian. And he says this, that he can't, if he was here, he could not see your faces. He can't see that far. But he's an upbeat person. He's a positive person. And I'll say something about the beautiful day that God has given us. He said, God paints a beautiful picture. I said, I enjoy my life. Do you enjoy your life, Mike? He said, I enjoy every second. I enjoy every minute. I enjoy every hour, every day, every year. I enjoy it because God has given it to me. You know, sometimes we don't appreciate what God has done for us. And if we don't appreciate what God's done for us, we can't have the compassion and the concern and the care that we ought to for other people. I don't want to live a selfish life. I don't want to be a selfish person. Well, if I've got something good, I want to share it, don't you? Yeah. If I get a good deal, I like to tell people, go down there at that store, man, they got a good deal going on. I like to tell people. But the greatest news that we could share with anybody is the news of the gospel. The death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Salvation, salvation, salvation. Now listen, when we really get concerned about that, I know people are different emotionally. I know that we weep at funeral, but we don't sorrow as others who have no hope when our loved one has died in Christ. But I know people have different emotional makeup. But it's to the point that people need to know that we really care about them. We care about somebody besides ourselves. I know that's not popular in this world. I know that's not politically correct anymore to care about other people. But God has loved us. He has saved us. He has forgiven us. We ought also to love one another. And people ought to know that. They ought to understand that. They ought to see that in our lives. I close with this. This is my commitment as a Christian. I'm a part of the fellowship of the unashamed. I have Holy Spirit power. The die has been cast. I've stepped over the line. The decision has been made. I'm a disciple of His, and I won't look back. And I won't let up, and I won't slow down. I won't back away, and I won't be still. You see, my past is redeemed. My present now makes sense. My future is secure, and I'm finished with done with low living and sight walking and small planning and smooth knees and colorless dreams and tame vision and mundane talking and cheap living and dwarf goals. I no longer need the preeminence or the prosperity or the position or the promotions or the plaudits or the popularity. See, I don't have to be right. I don't have to be first. I don't have to be tops, recognized, praised, regarded, or rewarded. You see, I now live by faith. I lean on His presence, and I walk by patience. I'm lifted up by prayer and labor by the power of the Holy Spirit of God. My face is set. My gate is fast. My goal is heaven. My road is narrow. My way is rough. My companions are few, and my guide is reliable. My mission's clear. I can't be bought, compromised, detoured, lured away, turned back, deluded, or delayed. I'll not flinch in the face of the sacrifice. Hesitate in the presence of the adversary. Negotiate at the table of the enemy, or ponder at the pool of popularity, or meander in the maze of mediocrity. This is the last paragraph. Here's where we are. I won't give up, and I won't shut up, and I won't let up until I've stayed up and stored up and prayed up and paid up and preached up for the cause of Christ. I'm a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. I must go till He comes. I must give till I drop. I must preach till all know and work until He stops me. And when He comes for His own, He will have no problem recognizing me. My banner will be clear. I'm a child of the King. Now the question today to us is, Jesus cares about us. How much do we care about Him? How much do we care about others? How much do we care about our own family? How much do we care about our own friends? How much do we care about our co-workers and our neighbors? When I worked in a shop, Peace Company there in Hamilton, we built prefabricated homes. Those of us that were in church, we'd come in on Monday morning, we were singing and whistling. the other crowd that was lost, they would come in and they'd have headaches and hangovers and all those kind of things. You know, they really had a good time. What'd you do? Oh, I had a really good time. What'd you do? I got real drunk. I threw up all night. I was sick all weekend. Oh, you had a good time. Okay, yeah. They didn't want us to whistle. They didn't want us to sing Amazing Grace. They didn't want us to be joyous. We couldn't help it. We've been in church all day on Sunday. God done something in our hearts. And God did something in that shop. And it wasn't because of us, but God used us. And the men in that shop, the Lord started saving them. There was a different atmosphere in that shop. There was a different spirit in that shop. Many of them came to church and were baptized and started serving God. It changed our shop. It turned our shop upside down. God did that. God did that. I remember when my dad died, my dad had been a drunk and God had saved him, and he'd spent the rest of his life serving God and preaching and all of those kind of things for years and years and years, and he lived what he preached. He was a hard preacher, but he lived what he preached. And when he died, he had a little smile on his face and he was on up in glory. And our family stayed there for a while. We've been singing before he died and quoting scripture and things of that nature. And after he died, we spent some time mourning and weeping and saying, "We'll miss you." But we left the room that day arm in arm, our whole family, about 20-something of us, and we went down the halls of that hospice facility singing Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound. It saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. You know what? When I went back in to thank those people, they said, "What a testimony that was, that you people know the Lord and you could sing Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound, even at the death of your father and your loved one." Boy, I will tell you, that's hope. That's hope that we have in Jesus Christ. And I pray that all of you today, if you're not saved, that you will be saved. And if you are saved, that you'll get serious about God's business and living for God and being what God would have you to be. Somebody thinks you're the greatest person that has ever lived. That may be your children, maybe your spouse, maybe your grandchildren, maybe your neighbor, maybe your coworker. But you represent Christ to them. You're the ambassador preacher talked about today. What kind of ambassador are we? Are we one that cares about others and loves others to the point of being emotional, maybe even weeping over those that are lost and those that are backslidden, the broken homes, and over our city and over our country? Let's pray. Father, I thank you today for the opportunity to be in your house. I pray, dear Lord, that you've taken the message and found lodgment in all of our hearts today. I pray that we would be concerned, we would have compassion, we would have care for other people, not just ours and our family and our friends and our neighbors, but for others. And I pray now that you'll bless in this time of invitation. I pray that if there's someone here without Christ as Savior, that today would be the day of salvation for them. And those that are saved, I pray they'd be obedient, baptism, church membership, serving the Lord in this New Testament Baptist Church. And forgive us of our sins, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Brother Keith.